gracious introduction, and thanks all of you for coming out. So, not working?
Closer.
Working now? Thank you so much. Okay. So Jeremy and I will talk for some period of time, and then I think Jeremy would be happy to take lots of questions. So, Jeremy, before we get to how it is that Jason came to be, I want to ask you a little bit about why it felt necessary to bring it into being. So, you use in your new book, but also elsewhere, this expression, the loudest 8%. So, explain who the loudest 8% are, and also why they have been so incredibly successful at shaping America's policy towards Israel so far.
First of all, let me just add my thanks, James, to Kate, in particular, for her wonderful introduction, for her work here in New York. So I just want to publicly acknowledge her. New York is a political director as well as in the second row, and there's a bunch of J Street staff and interns who are around the room, and I just want to say at the beginning thank you very much to them. Thank you to all of you as well for coming in a unusual heat wave, even for the middle of July, and to have this many people in the room. I really appreciate your dedication and your interest. Today's a great day to ask that question, because we actually released a new poll. We do polling on behalf of J Street, of the American Jewish community, pretty regularly to get a sense of where the Jewish community is in its attitudes about Israel and about American foreign policy. And one of the questions that we always ask to try to better understand the texture of American Jewish voting decisions is, what are the two issues that are most important to you in deciding who you're going to vote for, how you're going to vote in a particular election? And surprisingly to us, every single poll that we do finds roughly 7 to 10% of the American Jewish community, American Jewish voters, mention Israel in an open-ended question as one of the two issues that's most important to them when they vote. The 8% that does mention Israel as one of their two most important issues is the 8% that is the loudest and most engaged and most involved on this issue. They are the people who wake up in the morning reading about this issue, go to sleep at night talking about this issue. In the middle of the day, they're calling their member of Congress, they're telling their rabbi, maybe be more careful with their sermon. They're calling up the Hillel where their kid goes to school and saying, how come you had that speaker? Those are the people who are the voice that people hear out there in our community. And when you look at their political views, and you look at their views on issues related to Israel, they're not necessarily in sync with the other 92%. So the voices and the organizations that work on this issue that traditionally have dominated the debate present a face to the rest of the world that's out of sync with the rest of the community. It's a face that is to the right of us as a whole, as a community, when it comes to these issues. It tends to be more hawkish in views on American foreign policy, on views towards Israel, approval ratings, let's say, of right-wing politicians, both in this country and in Israel. And so the rest of us needed a voice. That's the voice that had been heard, and it's the voice that skewed American foreign policy in a direction that I believe has been unhealthy and unhelpful for Israel. So J Street was an effort to recapture the voice of this part of the community and to engage us again in the political dialogue.
So again, before we get to J Street, so that explains why there's this misconception that American Jews think this. But isn't it also true that if you're thinking about the constituency of the kind of Israel right or wrong crowd, you know, they don't want to give any debate just the way you've described, are most of those people that 8%, or in fact is the overwhelming fraction of that, of those people, conservative Christian Americans? That is to say that group of 8% of Jews actually is not solely determinative, maybe not even chiefly determinative, of what has been a surprisingly Israel right or wrong point of view at the highest political levels.
This is going to sound canned. It sounds like I have an answer to relate to today for anything that happens, but today,
what a gifted speaker you are.
Today happens to be the annual convention of Christians United for Israel. KUFI, which is John Hagee's organization. I don't know how many people in the room know what KUFI is. I don't know if you know who John Hagee is. But you're exactly right. In Washington, D.C. today, there are probably well over 10,000 evangelical Christian Zionists who are gathered for the annual convention of KUFI. And they are going to be up on Capitol Hill tomorrow. And I saw their lobbying agenda and their talking points, and it is astounding. To see a community and have an even larger presence than our largest organizations in the Jewish community, 700,000 members of KUFI. And they can get over 10,000 people onto Capitol Hill for a lobbying day when it's 110 degrees in the middle of July in Washington, D.C. And they're going to get the attention of the members of Congress in the middle of the greatest debt and deficit crisis that this country's ever known. They're going to get the meetings and they're going to get the attention. So you're right. The dynamics around this issue, the politics around this issue, are partly shaped by the Jewish community. They're also affected by the evangelical Christian community. But I still believe that the key to this in the end really is the Jewish community, that the unlocking of all of the dynamics around it begins with reconfiguring,
like with your microphone.
Talk with your hands, this is what happens. Unfortunately, it's very loose. It begins with reconfiguring the voice of the Jewish
people. Well, so I want to come back to this question of kind of where Americans generally stand on Israel, because I think it's a problem for anybody in your situation. But was it good before? Was it bad before?
Too loud?
It's better now? I figured it out. Figured it out. It's good. It's good. Okay. Everyone's happy? We're happy. Okay, because we have a lot of talk ahead of us. Okay, so let's then talk about, explain how it is that J Street came to pass.
Well, I think that there are a lot of people, and some of them are in this room, who have felt through decades of involvement in American politics and decades of involvement in issues related to Israel, that they didn't have a place. They didn't have a home in the Israel advocacy community. They didn't have a voice in the Washington debate. Their voice when it came to politics had sort of been hijacked by other people. And there were groups out there claiming to speak for all of us, and claiming to represent the entirety of the Jewish community and to speak for everybody who cares for Israel. And I knew, and Victor Kovner knew, and many of the other folks in this room who were involved in many other organizations knew, they don't speak for us. They don't speak for me, they don't speak for us, they don't speak for a large swath of the Jewish community and other supporters of the state of Israel. So J Street came into being because so many of us with a deep involvement in politics and a deep involvement in the Jewish community said it's time for us to come together and say, no, you know, you have an opinion, we have an opinion. Ours is just as valid as yours. We all love Israel, we all want the same thing, which is security and peace and a democratic and a Jewish Israel. We want it to be there for our kids and our grandkids. That's a shared goal. But we have different opinions on how to get there, and that's legitimate and that's valid, and we need a way to express ourselves. So that's the origin of J Street.
So what was the reaction to J Street's birth from AIPAC, ADL, those folks? Did they say, oh, now we have a more broad spectrum of opinion, or what did they say? You already know the answer, don't you?
Well, I think the interesting thing is that those particular institutions actually ignored us, you know, and there was actually there's a campaign of, as many of you know, and many of you are actively involved in J Street, both here in New York and nationally, and you know that there's an active campaign of vilification and sneers and lies. But what happens, and I think is so fascinating, is that the sort of attack dog role is left to others. You know, you have people like a Jennifer Rubin, who blogs on the Washington Post website, or you have the TAC group, like the Emergency Committee for Israel, that gets set up with millions of dollars from private sources that include
Wait, people. Did you get set up with millions of dollars from private sources?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Absolutely.
I want to make sure.
Right. No, absolutely. And that's the rules of the game.
Yeah.
And in fact, one of the things that J Street is about is that we're going to play the game by the exact same rules as the other side, which has not been done before. And it's legal and it's allowed and it shouldn't be. We can talk about changing campaign finance rules and we can talk about greater public disclosure, but if the other side is going to play by those rules, why shouldn't we? And those attack machines, whether it's Bill Kristol's emergency committee or it's these bloggers like Pam Geller and the American Thinker and all of those sort of places, those are the places that do the attacking, and the traditional organizations stand back and have an arm's length relationship and are able to say, well, you know, we are not sure about what they're about, and let's wait and see, and they don't come right out and do it themselves. So I don't want to leave the impression that the institutions of the establishment of the Jewish community have done the attacking, but there are sort of an attack squad around them that's doing the
job. Okay, let's talk about how those established organizations, APAC and so on, take an issue. I don't know whether it should be the reaction to the Gaza war. I mean, you kind of choose one. And talk about how, in the absence of J Street, they've been able to drive debate in a certain direction or preclude certain things from being said.
Well, I think, you know, let's take the example of the situation we're in right now with the president having given some speeches in May that outline a vision that actually make tremendous sense, which is to have a border between these two people based on the 1967 lines with swaps. It's about as uncontroversial in Middle East policymaking as any idea could be. And yet when the president puts it forward, there is an immediate rush to judgment of, oh my goodness, the president has attacked Israel. What he's doing is putting Israel's defense at risk. And it's egged on by the prime minister of Israel, of course. I mean, you know, let's be clear that this all begins with his essentially attacking the president in the Oval Office when he was here visiting.
Is it fair to say that Netanyahu inside Israel has been seeking to discredit Obama?
Oh, I think it's a matter of public record. That, you know, some of the statements made by him and people around him are in public domain.
That was seen as an anti-Israel
right. Record. And I think that the logical next step comes then when you go to Capitol Hill and you have the resolutions and the letters that circulate that get 300 or 400 signatures in the House and 89 in the Senate that suddenly say, you know, oh my God, you know, what do you mean 67 lines? This we have to leave this to the parties instead of backing up the president, who's laying out what has been a bipartisan foreign policy that is in the best interest, the national interest of the United States, backed by generals, backed by secretaries of state, national security advisors. Instead of seeing a bipartisan show of support for the president articulating a path to resolving the conflict, you get a bipartisan letter saying, no, 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 red light, stop, do not pass go. You have just violated the rules of American politics.
Does APAC write those letters?
Advocacy groups traditionally have a very strong role, as we play a role in our letters, in writing letters and helping.
They just don't get 300 signatures.
We do not get 300 signatures yet, but that we're hoping over time to shift the momentum.
But yes, that's what groups seek to do. But I mean, my impression is that APAC, like the NRA or AARP, has just been remarkably successful, not just in the writing of those letters, but for example, in the writing of the language resolutions which Congress votes on, the writing of legislation and so forth.
Absolutely. I mean, the playbook, you know, I look at this very objectively as a student of politics and a student of advocacy, and I think we all should. We should study those who succeed and understand how they do it and understand their tactics. And for those who want to be effective in Washington, D.C., study the playbook that was put into play by APAC, by groups like the NRA. You may not like what they are doing, and you may disagree with what they are substantively doing, but learn from them. Learn how to be effective, and that's exactly the case with APAC. I have great respect for what they did and how they did it, and we have learned a lot from them, and I think we're putting a lot of the ideas into practice for our own purposes.
But I want to come back now to this 8% question, because it does seem astonishing when you think about it that opinion, Capitol Hill was the one place where opinion until you folks came along, was the most uniform. You could not debate certain things, you could say certain things, and so forth. Now, can that really be attributed to a small number of zealots, whether it's the 8% or even a small number of Christian evangelical zealots? Or is it also because, for reasons we can talk about, the majority of Americans, or a really big number of Americans, of whatever faith, basically take the Israelite or Mormon point of view?
And we do consistent polling on exactly that question. And among American Jews, we don't poll the entirety of the American public on the question of Israel. We poll Jewish Americans. And there are super majorities. I mean, 60, 70, 80% of Jewish Americans are very comfortable with the President of the United States actively promoting a resolution of this conflict, even if it means criticizing publicly the policies of the government of Israel and of the Palestinians, even if it includes using the word pressure, placing pressure on both sides. What I want to make really clear, though, and everybody should hear very loudly and clearly, what Jewish Americans want is fairness. They don't want to see a president who they perceive is pressing only one side, only putting the pressure on the Israelis in particular. And that is something that we see in the polling shifting over the last 2.5 years. There is a perception, we saw in our poll today, that the president at times only presses the Israelis to make concessions, and that's an impression that the Jewish public has, and it is shifting.
Which, by the way, you would say is an unfair impression.
Which I would say is an unfair impression, but it is still the impression.
Is that, one of those things which you think is being fostered by that small group?
It is an echo chamber. I mean, there is a definite echo chamber between the very large infrastructures that are out there and the reach that they have into the community and the blogosphere and the media and all of the email chains, viral emails that go around. There's a definite echo chamber that takes these perceptions and turns them into reality in people's minds.
But still, Jeremy, you answered my question about what Americans in general think by talking about what Jews in general think. And obviously, Jews are way more liberal than Americans generally. And I mean, when people abroad say to me, how come America's policy is like this? I say, well, you don't realize that most Americans are just super pro-Israel, and so there's a tremendous amount of support for that. So isn't part of the difficulty that you have that it's not just the 8%, it's not just the extremely conservative evangelicals, it's a kind of default mentality?
I would push back against you because I don't think that what shapes the political constraints on policymakers in Washington is general public opinion.
Doesn't matter what 51% is.
No, I mean, I think that the number of times that Israel comes up in a general public event or a general fundraiser or from a non-Jewish donor, except with a handful of exceptions, perhaps on the Christian right, I really think that that has not got any impact. From my experience, personally, as well as from what I hear from others, the impact is from the Jewish community. There's a disproportionate impact. Facts are the facts. A very large portion of the money that is raised in American politics comes from Jewish Americans, and so they have an impact in what they bring to the attention of politicians during the fundraisers, during the access that they have. And therefore, this issue is raised more often by Jewish Americans than it is by others. And I think it is the opinion of this community that matters when politicians think about how much room do I have, how much latitude do I really have.
Now, you say in your book something which you say troubles you, which is that when you talk to the next generation of Jewish leaders, you talk to Jews in their 20s, 30s, 40s, I think the quote is you say that they view Israel as a headache or an impediment. Because that's just, their heads are not going to die. They don't want to think of it. Their Jewish identity doesn't have to do with Israel. So that sounds like the problem is that the people who care, this small number of people, care passionately about this. I guess it's like gun control that way. And then the vast majority of people of Jews care passionately about a bunch of other things, but not this one.
Now, that's the exact dynamic, and it does apply across issues. I mean, I think this is part of the explanation why in many, many communities and in many, many issues, a small, passionate group can push a position that's out of touch with the majority. And that's exactly what's happening here. What is happening, I think, inside the Jewish community in America, which saddens me deeply, is to watch younger Jewish Americans, particularly younger liberal and progressive Jewish Americans, pulling back from a connection, from wanting to even have a relationship with Israel, and at times also pulling back from the Jewish community. They'll pursue their Jewish identity and their Jewish values in a new way, through new organizations, through independent spiritual communities, through social justice initiatives that are sort of grassroots and just starting up, but they steer clear of some of the more traditional approaches because it just makes them uncomfortable as they pull away.
It makes them uncomfortable because it has to do with a sort of discomfort with Israel. They see Israel today as not being the kind of country they feel a sense of identity with.
Well, I think the discomfort is that it's so unnatural to not be able to discuss it. You know, that you can't even begin to talk about, well, why is this happening? And isn't it wrong? Isn't there something wrong about the way things are going? And if you aren't allowed to even ask those questions, that in and of itself is a turnoff. That says to me, well, this isn't the kind of community that I necessarily want to be a part of. And it doesn't jive with our views and our values on everything else.
But that sounds like you're giving a lot of credit now to the loudest 8%. You're saying they're actually succeeding in giving a false impression of apathy among many of the other 92%. Maybe they're just apathetic.
But it comes to I think you said it before, though. I mean, the passionate minority is very, very passionate. The majority is not that passionate. So if you have a synagogue that is planning, let's say, to have me speak, and four members of the synagogue call the rabbi and give half an hour harangues to say, I can't believe you're going to have this guy come and speak.
I'm guessing you're not using a hypothetical.
No, I mean, this is Beth Avodah in Newton, Massachusetts. It's one of the instances I talk about in the book.
Which I assume is kind of a liberal Newton, Mass. It must be pretty
Newton,
liberal
Massachusetts,
right?
All places, right. And the rabbi gets four angry phone calls from donors who threaten to pull funding. Maybe they've got a capital campaign. I can't remember exactly what was going on, but who had a handful of people who then go to the president of the board and say, did you realize what the rabbi is doing? How dare you? This is an anti-Israel organization, radical and leftist and out of touch. The president of the board not necessarily being all that engaged in his issues, part of the 92%, not really knowing what J Street is, not understanding it, gets frightened by the term anti-Israel, says, well, I certainly don't want anything going on in my synagogue that's anti-Israel. And next thing you know, it's pulled. The program's pulled. And we end up down the street in a school instead of at the synagogue. Because that small group, a handful of loud, vociferous people on one side of this issue, has the ability to stifle debate.
Is this, I mean, obviously you're relatively new to this game, but is this a phenomenon you would have found just the same 20 years ago? Or is there something about this moment that has created this greater virulence or vehemence against an institution like yours?
Well, you know, there's a number of people I know in the crowd who have been at this for a lot longer than I have, and I think that many of them would vouch for the fact that this has been going on for a very long time. I don't know, is there anybody here who was involved in Grey Rock? Hey, thank you, Gil. Good to see you. There was an organization called Grey Rock that started about 35 years ago that had a lot of these views. It was way ahead of its time. I mean, this was well before any of this conversation was really breaking out in the community as a whole, and they were shut down. I mean, really, literally brought to a complete halt by this kind of attitude. And that has been the case over the decades in the Jewish community. So it's, I think the temperature is literally higher today in the community, not just in this hall. But it is worse in a way than it has been, but it has always been fairly bad. And that's one of the dynamics that I think we have to break. The Jewish community thrives over the centuries on debate. You know, our people and our values and our learning and our tradition has been advanced through argumentation, through discussions. How people learn in yeshivas, it's how our great-grandparents and great-great-grandparents and everybody advanced the scholarship of our people and the learning of an incredible community. It's through argument and debate and discussion and dissent. And to say that you even if you really, really hate what I have to say, and I personally don't think what I'm saying is all that radical, but if you really, really hate it, the best way to counter it is to sit in the chair and argue.
So where did this, I mean, you're describing an un-Jewish attitude, right? I mean, this unwillingness to have debate, you know, this vilification. So where did this un-Jewish attitude in the heart of the Jewish world come from?
I think to be fair to it, I think it comes from a place of fear and from a real emotion. I think that people approach this issue from a really primal place. And particularly at a distance, particularly people who don't live in Israel. I think in our community, people are very wary and very afraid. They don't want to do anything that might lead to the destruction of the state of Israel.
But it's not a generational thing anymore, right? It's not, once upon a time, you would say, these old mockers, they're the Holocaust, they have a sense that the Holocaust is going to happen tomorrow because it's within their experience. Now we're talking about younger people for whom it's not central to their experience, right?
I still think it's generational. I mean, I still think there is a piece of that. I think that, you know, for people who are older than me, I'm right at the pivot point. I talk about this in the book. You know, I was alive when the 1967 war took place. I was in synagogue for Yom Kippur on 1973. I remember the feelings of all the adults around me. So I still have at least a visceral feeling, and everybody older than me, you know, maybe much older, went through 1948, went through World War II, but at least their parents did. But the people who are younger than me, this is really history, and this is really not their personal experience, it's not even their parents' experience. And I think it still is generational, and I think the people in their 60s who are at the peak of their careers in the Jewish community and are running the federations and running the institutions, I still think they have that mentality. And I think it pervades the community.
It's an encouraging thought in a way, although, you know, Eric Cantor, to take a name out of hat, probably younger than you are, right? You know, and Eric Cantor, you know, has the view that if America deviates in any way whatsoever from the way Netanyahu defines Israel's interest, then it's bad. And there seem to be an amazing number of people in the U.S. Congress.
Well, how many of them actually, I mean, Cantor does really hold it, but how many of them really hold it, and how many say they hold it because they're afraid of what the political consequences are? I mean, I don't think there are a handful of people in the Congress who do hold those views ideologically.
But you think it's just a really small number, though?
I really don't think it's that large a number. I think the vast majority of people who consistently toe that line and are sort of providing the blockage to American policy actually helping to resolve this conflict. I really don't think they're ideologically committed. I really think they're politically afraid. And again, I think this is a political problem. That's why we set J Street up as a political organization with a PAC and with a lobbying arm. And that's what has to be changed.
So let's talk about that then. So this is where, if that is the case, it really means that, as you say, the answer lies in politics, fighting politics with politics. So talk a little bit about places where you feel you've been able to make progress such that somehow the culture, the narrative, the whatever, is a little different now from what it would have been before you guys came along.
Well, I think it's hard to point that, and I'll be very, very honest. You know, we've been at it for 3 years, and I would say that trying to take on this dynamic that's been in place and set in stone for decades and is backed by, you know, several hundred million dollar machinery, trying to change that in just 3 years has not been a success. I'm the first to acknowledge that. I can't tell you we've reversed this and we have to declare victory. But what I can say is that behind the scenes, when we sit with members of Congress, and if there were, you know, a number of our folks that we just took to Israel 3 weeks ago on a trip, they were sitting here talking to you, they would talk about the tremendous change that has happened, that there is an alternative being presented in a coherent, organized, consistent way, backed up with political muscle, backed up with grassroots advocacy that wasn't being done before. And we, in fact, you know, sponsor trips to Israel for members of Congress that give them a why lens on the conflict and show them the multiple sides. They meet with the settlers, who, by the way, you won't meet if you go on an APAC trip. We'll have you meet with the settlers. And they'll meet with the human rights groups, who, of course, you won't meet if you go on the adventure. So, you know, that's the spectrum, and we try to give them the entirety of the picture so that they really get a sense and go and sit with the IDF, the Israel Defense Forces General Staff, and understand what they see as the threats, and then go sit with the former heads of the IDF who say that this government has it all wrong.
But do those folks who go on these trips tend to be the ones who are already the converts, from your point of view?
They are the people who think like us, but who 5 years ago wouldn't have done anything at all along these lines. That's what I'm, you know, saying, is that these members of Congress, if there were no political constraints, we could get majorities to support what the president is trying to do, and he would have much more freedom to actually do it and not just talk about it. They want to do this. They agree with us. Anybody who has spent a lot of time on this issue and who's objective does agree with us. We just need to give them the space. So for many of these people, this is giving them the space to begin to talk about it. So we had five of our five friends at J Street who did go on the trip with us, and it's they take a lot of heat for going on the trip.
Well, that was my next question. It was the is the price they pay for departing from the official line, has that price gotten a little lower, or no? Basically, it's just as great a sense of kind of demonization as has traditionally been the case.
Well, we're trying to do two things. One is to actually help them see that the price isn't that great. There's a lot of smoke and mirrors here, but how many members of Congress have actually been defeated because they said something on this issue that didn't line up with the establishment? Very, very, very few. But they're held up as examples to scare and frighten the other people.
Is that to say that APAC's bite is a little worse than its...
The bark,
bark is a little worse than its bite?
Bark is worse than the bite.
That's what it is to say.
Right, yeah, no, and so part of it is to show them that if you do this, and you get the angry calls, and somebody says to you, you know, if you do this, you will never raise another dime, you know, from American Jews, or if you do this, you know, there will be a primary campaign against you.
Lunch
and then, you know, you wait for the other shoe to drop, and it doesn't actually drop. Now, some people, let's say Jan Schakowsky, I'll take her as an example. In 2010,
she's at Illinois.
Right, Jan Schakowsky is a member of Congress from Chicago, Jewish, really wonderful woman, a leader in the Democratic caucus in the House, really progressive, very good on every single issue that, that you know many of us care about. And she decided to accept our endorsement as a really significant senior Jewish leader in the House. It was a big deal for her. Well, she got a Republican Tea Party Orthodox Jewish opponent in the last election who would walk into town halls with her on stage with a map of Israel and say, that's what this election is about. So I can't imagine
a laboratory test.
Right, no, I can't imagine, you know, there's not going to be many times in the history of American politics when you have this happen. So the fear that everybody has is, oh my God, you know, this is Evanston, Illinois, there's a lot of Jews in the district, they're all going to kill Jan Schakowsky, she's going to lose, it's going to be awful for her. She won re-election with 67% instead of 70%. You know what, 2010 wasn't that great a year for Democrats, you may have heard. So dropping from 70 to 67, and this is from a well-funded opponent who had Alan Dershowitz come in and attack Jan Schakowsky and raise money for him, and you know, had the whole apparatus of the Republican Jewish Coalition and $1 million of outside paid advertising on this issue in Jewish media and couldn't move the needle. So, A, we're trying to prove the bark is worse than the bite, and you really don't have that much to fear. And B, the positive. We can support these people. We who hold these views have the option of actually writing checks and raising money and actually providing support. We don't have to just sit back and say, oh my God, you know, this is terrible.
So as a PAC, do you have enough dough that you can make a significant difference in a significant number of races, and you may choose whatever meaning you want to assign to the word significant?
Right, the word significant is hard, but we have a $4 billion system of campaign funds that are raised, right? I mean, this is an extraordinary system in this country that needs to be radically reformed, but that's the system we have. So we, as J Street PAC, in our second cycle, raised more money than any other pro-Israel PAC in the country. In fact, we raised over one-third of all of the pro-Israel money that was raised in our only second cycle.
And how much money is that?
$1.5 million. And in an individual race, let's say Joe Sestak running for Senate last cycle in Pennsylvania, we raised over $150,000. So we were his third largest conduit of funds raised. And Jan Schakowsky, we raised over $75,000 for her, nearly one-tenth of all the money that she raised in the race.
So that gets the attention of professional people in Washington when they see that you've got that kind of money.
So it's two parts to the political message. One is, don't be so scared, the bark is worse than the bite. And number two, we as a movement can begin to pool people's money, begin to support folks who stand up, show some leadership, show some courage, and begin to show that actually there's an alternative base to go to for support, and that's what J Street's trying to build.
So, at some point soon, I'll want to hear questions from all of you, but let's talk a little bit about Israel. We haven't really talked. I mean, this whole thing, after all, is all about trying to bring a good outcome in Israel. And this is not a moment when it's possible to feel terribly optimistic. So, talk a little bit about your sense of where public opinion lies on the big peace questions in Israel, and whether there's really anything that's going to push Netanyahu out of what appears to be his current comfort zone.
Well, let me start by saying, and I totally agree with you, this is not a moment of great optimism on a variety of fronts. You have a very intransigent government in Israel. You have a Palestinian leadership that has basically said, and I can understand it, that this whole process of negotiations has reached a dead end and we're going to go a different route. And you have an American administration that gives good speeches but doesn't follow through with real action. So if you look at all of the pieces, it's not a moment of great optimism. But in the book, what I say is, we should be sounding the alarm. I mean, if people in this room care about the state of Israel, if you care about its future, if you care about the character of the state, about it being a democracy, about it being a Jewish home, and you want it to be safe and secure and survive, you should be sounding the alarm at this time. Because with all those factors, that's not just an analytical problem that we can sit back and say, oh, well, things are really bad. No, if you care about this, you should be, you know, taking to the streets about this, and you should be doing something about it. And that's, I hope that this book, and I hope our movement, is trying to serve as a wake-up call to people to say, if you really are pro-Israel, if you really do care about the future, if you care about security, if you care about the Jewish people's future in that land, and you want it to be something that represents you, then get involved, get active. So I think part of this is, it's very, very stark when you look at where things are at. There is an iceberg dead ahead, right? And the ship is headed straight for it. We have to change course. And in my opinion, we are very critical as J Street of the policies of this government of Israel. We are not critical of Israel. We are critical of the policies of this government. And we hope that this something will arise out of Israel to change course. There are all sorts of new initiatives, the Israel Peace Initiative, the Independence Hall Movement, there are all sorts of new initiatives in Israel that are coming out of the streets and starting to get people awakened. There's some that are more radical, like the Sheikh Jarrah Solidarity Movement that just had a march of 3,000 people in Jerusalem with Arabs and Jews together to speak out on behalf of a different future. So there is stuff bubbling from all parts of
it. Obviously, Israel has always had Peace Now and other pro-peace movements, but my sense is that Israeli public opinion right now is very nervous about any form of pressure and tends to rally to Netanyahu's side, and Netanyahu is great, as you said earlier, at provoking that rallying effect.
Now, that's one of the reasons I'm so worried about the BDS approach, boycott, divestment, and sanctions approach to this problem. I'm worried about the impact of the UN, because I just worry that the reaction in Israel to pressure is to circle the wagons. I worry that that's not the way to get people to listen. And my hope is that we, as friends, we as cousins, we as supporters of Israel, can talk to Israelis as our partners, as our fellow Jews, to say to them, wake up. Look at where this ship is headed. Look at that iceberg dead ahead. And do it not out of negative pressure, because I don't think that will work. I'm very worried about those approaches. But do it instead out of love, as partners. We've been partners over all the generations. We send money, we lobby, we send our kids on birthright. Some of us try making Aliyah, we go there vacation. I mean, we do all these things to help Israel survive. Now we need to tell it the truth and say, wake up. It's time to change course before it's too late.
By the way, so you mentioned this fear that many of us have about the consequences of the movement among Palestinians to have gained recognition from the UN in September. But if you were a Palestinian, wouldn't you say, what better option do I have?
I think the frustration is totally understandable. Negotiations over 20 years have not produced results. And I don't think that there's any question that, you know, the President Abbas told us, it was in the New York Times reporter Ethan Bronner was with us in the meeting, that the Palestinians do not want to go to the UN as their first choice. They realize they're not going to gain freedom the day after a UN vote. This isn't the resolution of the conflict. This doesn't give them a state. It's a symbolic gesture that satisfies their feelings of frustration, but it doesn't produce the result. So President Abbas, Prime Minister Fayyad, the team that's around them, their first preference is to get this conflict resolved in a two-state negotiated resolution, but it has to be based on certain parameters. You have to have a starting point. They've been at it for 20 years. We know what the resolution of this conflict looks like. They understand it. Put forward the parameters and force a yes or no answer from both parties. Are you really serious about ending this with orders based on 67 with swaps, with a final resolution of all claims, with no right of return but compensation for refugees, with a division and a sharing of Jerusalem that allows the Jewish areas for Israel and the Palestinian areas for Palestine? Find out, are the parties serious? Put that on the table. Then the Palestinians will come back to the table. It's a serious effort. That's their preference.
So I'm going to go to the questions in a second. So just one more thing, though, because you also, just now, in a passing remark, criticized the Obama administration's approach as saying nice things but not actually doing anything. And I know with the book you say, big mistake to have focused on the settlements. So I guess a two-part question. A, what should they have done? And B, what are the main differences?
I mean, my feeling was, is, and will continue to be, that the parties know what the resolution of the deal looks like. We were to break into little committees and spend about 20 minutes outlining the basic points. We had 10 different groups. All 10 of our little groups would come up with the same basic outline of what the solution looks like. It's no secret. So the President of the United States, together with the quartet, together with the Arab League, together with the international community, should simply go there and lay down on the table what it is that we all know is the resolution of the
conflict. And that's what he should have done in 2009.
Starts, don't, you won't have a settlement issue if you have a border. You know, the settlement issue is a symptom, it's not the disease. It is time to just deal with the fundamental underlying problem, which is that we don't have a border between these two people. We need to divide up this territory into two states, come up with a border, and then there are no more settlements, because if you build within your border, it's your right.
Were you guys, by the way, I don't remember your stance on this. Were you saying that at the time?
Well, what
focus on settlements of the state, don't do that, focus instead on borders?
We said focus on borders. I mean, of course, we are opposed to settlements.
No, but in terms of strategy,
we backed up the president for saying Israel should stop building settlements, because that's our position. Israel should stop building settlements. Absolutely. But that was not the strategic call that we supported in order to actually get this going. We wanted them to put forward a plan that both sides would have to say yes or no to.
So let me read some of the questions. So the first one is the following. Is J Street making American foreign policy towards Israel a more partisan issue in Congress? Is this good for Israel?
I think that policy towards Israel is becoming a more partisan issue. I don't think that J Street is the cause of that. I think we're a symptom of that effect. The Republican Party, in my opinion, has drifted so far from its traditional roots. There used to be a bipartisan consensus on so many foreign policy issues. I mean, I grew up in high school studying this concept that political differences stop at the water's edge. I mean, probably nobody studies that anymore, because that is no longer a principle of American foreign policy. But if you think about it, Zbigniew Brzezinski and Brent Scowcroft are leading a group of former national security advisors, writing letters to the president, writing joint op-ed pieces, laying out their positions together. The national security advisors for Ronald Reagan and Jimmy Carter, together, writing what should be done. That doesn't happen anymore. And I don't blame J Street for that. I really think it's a terrible thing that it's happening, but the Republican, you can't find a Republican co-sponsor for a reasonable pro-peace letter. We had a couple
in the House, there's zero.
It really is zero. I mean, Charles Bustani and Jeff Davis were endorsees of J Street Act in the 2008 cycle. They took so much pressure and so much heat from within their own caucus, they were told they would never advance within their own party if they continued to do that. And so we are at zero.
Well, I say in that sense, you're probably just a symptom of the ideological purity of the current Republican Party in the House.
I don't believe we're a cause, but I think it's a terrible situation, and this partisanship does not serve Israel's interests, it doesn't serve America's interests.
So there are a lot of questions about the UN. Now, the one that I have in a card in front of me, you may have more or less answered, which is what J Street's stance on this whole September vote is. I think a broader question, though, that I hear all the time is the UN anti-Israel?
Well, you know, I think saying it's anti-Israel is probably an overstatement. I think there's no question there's been over-focus at the United Nations on Israel. It makes no sense. Why is such a high percentage, with all the problems in the world, why is such a high percentage of the time of the business of the United Nations devoted to this tiny little geographic area? Why the Human Rights Commission and Council has there been such a high percentage of resolutions on Israel? Sure, there are human rights issues to be dealt with there, but there are the human rights issues all over the world. So I think there has been an over-focus on Israel at the United Nations. So I think the entire body is in and of itself anti-Israel. No. The United Nations created the state of Israel. I mean, we can't forget that.
But is that over-focus just a reflection of global public opinion?
Well, I don't think that global public opinion, if you put in front of them all the problems that face the world, would put the Israeli-Palestinian conflict number one on the list. You know, there are a whole slew of terrible human rights situations going on all over the world. I do think there is an over-focus on Israel, and it has made many, many Jewish Americans in particular, and many Israelis, very, very wary of the United Nations as a body to go to resolve this conflict. And I think that wariness comes across when it comes to the idea that the United Nations is now going to recognize a state of conflict.
So to go to the specific question, what is J Street's view of what the Obama administration should do if, in fact, the question of Palestinian statehood comes to a vote in September?
Well, it depends also on exactly what that resolution is. I mean, there's two tracks that it could go down. I think one is a track where the entirety of the resolution is simply a state of Palestine that the United Nations recognizes as a non-member state, because they're going to probably not go to the Security Council.
Right.
Probably just go to the General Assembly. So the United Nations recognizes as a non-member state Palestine within 67 lines, with Jerusalem as its capital. If that's the resolution, then I think J Street would have to come out against that, because that is not the basis of a resolvable, agreed upon resolution to the conflict. I think it's a lot different if the resolution actually lays out the parameters we've been discussing. If it says there have to be two states.
This is a possible scenario, by the way?
Oh, I think there is, and I think that Europe holds the key. Ethan Bronner had a piece in the Times today. Thank you. My mother-in-law pointed it out to me. It was today in the New York Times talking about the interesting role that Europe is playing. And they are working to see whether, as Europe, they want to engage the Palestinians in coming up with a resolution that actually has content. And then J Street's going to be in a completely different position. So I believe that what J Street needs to argue for is not this or that on the UN. No matter what the UN resolution says, it doesn't end the conflict. Right? What we want is an end to the conflict. I'm looking at the day after the UN vote. I'm saying the focus of our movement and the focus of the United States government needs to be on what it's going to do to resolve this conflict. And this UN vote is, in a way, a bit of a distraction, because it may even inflame tensions and make conflict more likely rather than resolve it.
It also may put the Obama administration in a very ticklish position if it, as you say, it's not a pernicious sounding resolution, but one that's not so far away from the Obama administration's view. They nevertheless, if it does come to the Security Council, which I think it won't if it does, they may feel they have to go ahead and veto it, which of course would just increase the isolation of the United States on this issue.
Why don't we just build into our calculus? The United States is going to veto whatever resolution comes to the Security Council, and the United States is going to vote no on whatever resolution comes to the General Assembly. So just build that into the calculus.
Better have to be a bad resolution in that case.
Whether it's good or whether it's bad, whatever the resolution is, and that's just the political reality.
Yeah.
Whether this is good for the United States, for us as Americans, put aside Israel, put aside being Jewish, all of that. You know, the continuing isolation of the United States and the world over this issue is not a good thing for American credibility. It will happen. This is going to happen. but I don't know if it's a good thing.
So this, in a way, leads into the next question, which is, how much of the criticism of Israel in the international community is rooted in real anti-Semitism?
I think there's this tendency of some people to hear all criticism of Israeli policies as rooted in anti-Semitism, and I think it's so important to rip that apart, you know, and to try to really be clear. If somebody's willing to say they acknowledge the right of the state of Israel to exist, the right of the Jewish people to have a homeland of their own, the right of that state to defend itself and to use force when it's attacked, if you're willing to say all of those things, then you say, I think the government of Israel is making a mistake by expanding settlements. I think it is making a mistake by refusing to talk. That's not anti-Semitic. That, I mean, we just have to separate that out. And too often, a lot of our spokespeople and institutions will say anything at all that's critical of Israeli policy is anti-Semitism or anti-Israel. And I think
we're seeking to delegitimize
or this whole delegitimization
of the day.
Right. You know, and I think it's a terrible mistake because it delegitimizes the concept of delegitimization. You know what I mean?
And that needs to be said. I think it's that, thank God someone surfaced that.
It's crying wolf. It's crying wolf. You know, if you really have a serious anti-Semitism, which does exist in the world, save your cries of it for when it really surfaces, right? Because if you keep saying everything is anti-Semitism and then, oh my God, something actually happens, everybody's going to dismiss you as constantly complaining about it. So I think it's a big mistake to say all criticism of Israeli policy is anti-Semitic, based in anti-Semitism.
So here I have a really impossible question, which, alas for you, runs onto the other side of the car, because it gets more impossible as it goes. How is it possible? No, this is good. I should have asked it myself. How is it possible for J Street to counter the demographic trends in Israel? More and more religious, the Russian Jews who vote overwhelmingly Lieberman and Israel Beiteinu. As tragic as it sounds, isn't it a lost cause?
I don't think it's a lost cause. I mean, I think the demographic realities are the demographic realities, but I think that the overwhelming realities of the world are going to force people, even in unlikely parts of the Israeli society, to recognize, again, that iceberg. You know, whether you are, you know, a traditional Likud voter, or whether or not, you know, you are happen to be the descendant of a Russian immigrant to Israel, if you recognize that the course that your country is on is leading to imminent disaster, then out of self-interest, at some point, you'll shift gears. So I don't write off a whole community because they happen to have been born in a particular country, or, you know, they happen to have a certain set of religious beliefs. I don't buy that means you can't be rational.
You obviously can be, but just to go to the specific question, isn't it right that the complexion of the average Israeli voter is shifting to the right? Not just individually, but in this demographic sense that the question mentioned.
Absolutely, but I think, you know, take the Kadima party and its leadership. Tzipi Livni is the daughter of an Irgun leader. You know, she was in the Likud party. She is, views herself as a center-right person, and I think that's where she comes from. People like Tzipi Livni, who are part of that, you know, you would say the center-right, are going to support the rational resolution of this conflict. That's where the support is going to come from. It has to come not from the resurgence of the 20 or 25% that's left on the left, but it's going to come from the center and the center-right, and it's going to come out of a recognition of what is in the self-interest of the state of Israel. It's not going to come out of ideology. This shouldn't be seen as a right-left issue, and I think I'm really trying to help us shift that conversation. The things that J Street is saying aren't left-wing. The things that our opponents are saying isn't right-wing. What we're laying out is rational.
Well, but it sounds like you're trying to put a diplomatic gloss, as well you should, on a really tough set of facts. I mean, you look at someone like Avigdor Lieberman. He would not have been imaginable in the Israeli context as recently as 10 years ago.
So he gets 15% of the vote. Right? I mean, the Haredi parties get another 15% of the vote. That still leaves you 70% of the vote to play with. I mean, you have the chance to put together a coalition and a majority that would support a two-state solution. I think, for instance, one of the things to keep an eye on, for those who were watching these things in detail, who's going to be the leader of the Shas party? The Shas party is the Sephardi ultra-Orthodox party. Some people might dismiss them automatically just because they happen to be ultra-Orthodox. But if Arya Derry becomes the leader of that party, or if he splits off and forms another Sephardi ultra-Orthodox party, you have somebody who has in the past supported a two-state resolution, who is a rational person, and who can make a deal. And so there are opportunities, even with the demographic shifts, even with the political shifts, which are real, and I'm not denying them, but I'm saying that the decision needs 61 votes in the Knesset, it needs 51% majority, and you can construct that with the right coalition.
Okay. So now we have a question about the interlocutor on the other side of all this. So the question is, does Israel have a legitimate partner for negotiations with a Fatah-Hamas unity government? If so, why? The questioner adds the fact that after all, Hamas's charter contains a call to end the existence of the state of Israel.
So, you know, first just a factual statement, which is that there is no such thing at the moment as a Fatah-Hamas unity government. And let's just make sure we're all talking about the facts. An agreement to reach an agreement was signed in Cairo a few months ago, and they've made absolutely no progress in going any further than saying that they will eventually form some sort of a unity government. So right now, nothing has changed. And the government that you're dealing with is the government of Mahmoud Abbas and the government of Salam Fayyad as prime minister. And those two individuals, I believe, are the single best hope, and they may well be the single last best hope for Jews who want to see a two-state solution. And what we should be doing in the context of Palestinian politics is doing everything we can to help them succeed. We should seize this opportunity to work with them so that when they then run in an election, if a deal is carried out and they have an election and you have Fatah running against Hamas, the outcome is going to be far different. If Fatah runs, having accomplished a deal against Hamas that's saying we don't like the deal and we want to tear it apart, then the outcome will be if you have Fatah running with nothing to show for itself, and Hamas saying, you see, these guys have been talking deals for 20 years, they have nothing, and vote for us because we're the real change. We have a real ability, Israel has a real ability to affect how that plays out. So those are my two points. One is the facts on the ground today are this is still Abbas Fayyad as the government, so let's not overstate what happened with that unity deal. And number two, no matter what happens, there's still a tremendous role that Israel and the actions of Israel will play in how the political dynamics play out on the Palestinian side.
Just another Hamas question. Hamas in Gaza has occasionally made more moderate sounding noises than Hamas in Damascus. Is that a meaningful difference, or is that just artful spin from your point of view?
It appears that, like many revolutionary movements, there are a range of people involved in the movement. And there are people who are never, ever, ever going to compromise, and they will need to be defeated. And there are a range of people that sound more moderate. And the best way to figure out if that's good is actually to engage, rather than to, again, stonewall and say, you know, well, there's nothing to talk to, they're all alike. And I think it would be a tremendous mistake not to be trying to figure out whether or not those perceived differences are actual.
Okay. Another Israel question. I just read that Meir Dagan, the former Mossad chief, and Robert Baer warned that Israel would bomb Iran in September. What do you think?
Well, Meir Dagan did not warn that Israel was going to bomb in September. Robert Baer did. Meir Dagan was writing about, he's the former head of the Mossad. He just left months ago and made some public statements in June that were very critical of the decision-making process of the Netanyahu-Barak government, and basically said that he was afraid of the way that those leaders were approaching some of the decisions, particularly around Iran. And it was very controversial comments, and they are very worrisome because you have the former head of the Mossad and you have another former head of the Shin Bet who are now out of this government saying they are very concerned about where these political leaders are taking the country. So that's one concern that's very real, it's very worrisome, and I think their voices need to be heard, loud and clear by Jewish American leaders and community members. The question of the Robert Baer article, there's several of you in the audience actually who have corresponded with over the last week about this. This article has not been backed up by any other secondary sources. This is one guy who does occasionally throw out these sort of ideas. I don't put a lot of credibility into it.
Well, Seymour Hersh has been saying that the United States would be bombing Iran for years now.
Right.
Next year.
Next year.
Right. Okay. Okay. All right, back to the home front here. We are losing the left today. The positions are so skewed against any support for Israel. How do we bring them into the J Street fold?
The polarization around this issue is horrendous, whether it is on the left or the right. And, you know, I just hope that what J Street can succeed at and what we have to try to do is to create a sensible, rational place in the middle so that people who are critical of what's going on don't feel that their only option is to go to the far left. That their only option is to have a boycott Israel bumper sticker on their door. That shouldn't be the only option if you are concerned about what's going on there. And without a middle that J Street is trying to create, that's all you have. And I think that the left, you know, has found a political cause in what's going on in Israel and Palestine. And there's been no outlet for a rational middle of the road position. And I hope we can pull back, particularly some, you know, young Jews in particular, who would be attracted to whatever they can find that would protest what's going on there. And if we don't give them that middle ground, they're going to end up purely on the
Do you fear that those folks are going to discredit you? It'll just be very, very easy to smear J Street as being, in fact, anti-Israel in the way that parts of the left are?
Well, I mean, that's certainly what goes on day in and day out. I mean, that's the attempt. You know, our view is that it's better to engage with people that you disagree with rather than refuse to talk to them. So we will invite into our events and into our meetings people we disagree with to our left, and we'll engage them in a debate and a conversation, and we get attacked for doing that. But I just refuse. I think it is un-Jewish, it's undemocratic to say that when you don't like a position, I'm just not going to let the person come in and talk. And so that's been a controversial position for us. We don't support the global BDS movement. We do not actively promote any form of boycott, divestment, and sanctions as an organization, but we will share the stage with those who do and discuss the pros and the cons and why we don't and why they do. And I think that's the right approach.
All right, one last question. Have you made outreach to Muslim Americans or to Palestinians in Palestine to somewhat different issues?
Well, we work all the time with Muslims in America. I mean, there are groups like the Islamic Society of North America, the American Task Force on Palestine, the group MPAC, which is the Muslim Public Affairs Committee, are our partners often in lobbying and advocacy work. They are pro-two states. They oppose, obviously, a lot of Israel's policies, but they, again, they recognize Israel's right to exist. They recognize the right of the Jewish people to a home of their own and Israel's right to self-defense. And those are our criteria. We work with any organization that stands for those principles in the Muslim and Arab American community. I think that's really important. And those moderates do exist on the other side, and there's a constant effort to say that they don't, and it's really important to acknowledge that they do, and they're our partners in trying to find some rationality in a situation that's not very rational. In terms of Palestine, we do, you know, some very close friends, obviously, on the Palestinian side, particularly in the government at the moment, in the business community, people who we see, we work with, and are trying to find ways to promote our shared agenda.
Jeremy, I think you have more than earned your keep, and I hope you all go out and buy lots of books. Thanks so much.